And so as Samson's story is unfolded to us here in Judges chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16, we think Samson's the main character. He's center stage. That's where all the attention needs to be. But as we begin to read the story and get a little closer look, we realize that Jesus is actually on center stage, and that he's actually always the hero of every story that we read in the Bible. Well, good morning, everyone. Great to see you. Thank you for sharing part of your kind of sunny, wet Sunday with us here at North Broadway. Let me also give a shout out to those who are joining us online from wherever you may be watching. We say it every week, but you are an important part of who we are here at North Broadway. It was suggested that since I was a little over last week, like I went way over in my sermon, that I should cut it in half this week to make up for the time. I'm not too sure it's going to happen. Okay. Hey, listen, today we're wrapping up our series that we started a few weeks ago called On the Life of Samson. He truly has lived up to the name Bad Boy of the Bible. We said this series was kind of geared toward men, but there's been a lot for women to kind of digest through as well, a lot of these truths. It has been, I have to admit, one of the most frustrating stories in the Bible. A man who has so much potential for greatness, so much potential for spiritual greatness, and yet he let it slip all through his hands, his fingers. The story is amazing, it's perplexing, and at times it seems even contradictory. For boys that grew up in the church, Samson was like the hero. Everybody wanted to be like Samson. Who doesn't want to be strong like Samson? Who doesn't want to be a Rocky, a Rambo, or the Wolverine, or the Thor of the Old Testament? You know, Samson starts off so strong. He's invincible. He seems to be indestructible. Clearly, he's unbeatable. And he's what we all want to be, really, down deep inside. Samson was the strongest man who ever lived, and his trademark, we talked about this, was his hair. And as we have studied his life, we probably have been tempted along the way to think, oh, Samson's hair was his strength. And I think even Samson at times thought that was true, that it was his hair that it was his strength. But when you read every time Samson does some great deed or great feat, we read these words, that the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him. So when Samson was able to kill the lion with his bare hands, it said right before that, the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him. Just before Samson killed those 30 men at Ashkelon, the enemies, it says that the Spirit of the Lord came upon him. And then, of course, remember that one incident where it says he killed 1,000 of the enemies with the jawbone of a donkey. But before he did it, it says the Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon him. It seems as though the author of Judges has taken great pains for us to understand this is not Samson's strength. This is God's strength that Samson has. And here's the reality for Samson. No one had as much, oh my goodness, no one had as much going for him in the beginning of his life as Samson did. And that's why so often we're left to scratch our heads and say, what went wrong with Samson? How does a man who has so much going for him and so poorly in his life? Well, we have explored a few of those areas as to why strong men become weak or why strong men fail. That's the question we've been dealing with over the last couple weeks. And the first one we said is because oftentimes they disregard boundaries. We're just kind of going to do a quick review here. In fact, we said strong men who have great confidence in their ability to handle things often disregard boundaries, and they do it at great risk. See, sometimes we think, well, God set these boundaries to kind of steal a little bit of our joy. But the reality is God puts boundaries in our life so we can live life to its fullest. We can max out, actually, on life. Now, the second week, we said, strong men, why do strong men have this tendency to fail or fall? We said it's because they have a propensity for entitlement, lust, and pride. If you're just new here, you might be thinking, well, what does that all mean? Oftentimes, as men, we'll say, I want it. We call that lust. I deserve it. That's entitlement. I can handle it. We call that pride. And Samson was a womanizer, a skirt chaser. And he always thought he could handle whatever trouble he got into because he'd gotten out of messes before. I know men sometimes we think the same thing. I can handle it. I can handle this. The third week, we looked at how men can be driven by uncontrolled emotions. Now, I know as men, we say that's not even true. Women are emotional. Men are rational. But how many times have we as men done something, did something, said something, because our emotions, we lost control of our emotions? Well, Samson obviously is a great example of someone who had uncontrolled emotions. And last week, we probably looked at the most famous event in Samson's life. I think this Vienna waltz may best describe the story we looked at last week. I think we know that song. We know how that song turns out. Well, that's what we looked at in chapter 16. We're kind of introduced to Delilah, and really what we find out about her is that she was a gold digger because she was willing to sell out Samson to the highest bidder. She's going to retire early. And so, of course, the story unfolds, and we looked at that last week. And what we said is that in the beginning of chapter 16, it says one day, just one day, Samson headed toward Gaza. And you begin to think to yourself, well, what are you doing, Samson? Because his whole life is going to unravel really, really fast as he heads toward Gaza. We look at this story and we're like, well, Samson, this is craziness. What do you have, a death wish for you? Because he walks right into the enemy's headquarters. Like, what is he thinking? We would say, how could somebody be so dumb to jeopardize their whole life for a few sexual thrills? And that's exactly what he does. Because he's convinced, he's strong, he's confident, cocky, a little arrogant, he's a man. He can handle it. He can get out of messes because he's done it before. We talked about steps. We said he lived about 50,000 steps away from Gaza. You realize that if Samson had stopped at 49,999, he would have saved a whole life of heartache if he had turned around then. But 50,000 steps. Last week, we said men don't all of a sudden mess up their lives. Oh, no. We actually said they do it one step at a time. No one ever plans their life out thinking that some bad things are going to happen. No one ever plans to have an affair with their secretary and destroy their whole family. Nobody has. Nobody makes those kind of plans. And so that's why I'm always reminded of this verse. that says, "Be alert and sober-minded. Your enemy, the devil, roams like a roaring lion looking for someone to devour." We have an enemy. That's the truth. And the thing is, our enemy wasn't just want to bruise us a little bit. He's not looking just to push us around. He wants to take us out. He wants to devour our lives. That's our enemy. That's what we are fighting against on a daily basis. And Samson's episode with Delilah makes us all wonder, how did he not see the demise, his demise from the woman who shared his bed? We can't say Samson was tricked, because he wasn't. We can't say Samson was deceived, because he wasn't. He knew exactly what he was doing. How does that happen? How does that happen? You know how it happens? One step at a time. That's how it happens. Just a compromise here, a compromise over there, a couple compromises here, and before you know it, your life's messed up. One step at a time. And then we looked at some of the saddest words probably that are recorded in Scripture. In chapter 16, verse 20, we read these words that said, "But he did not know the Lord had left him." He didn't know. He thought he could wake up just like every other day. He did not know the Lord had left him. How sad of a statement is that? And let me tell you, if the story ended there, this would be the most depressing story in all of the Bible. If that's where the story ended, we'd walk away like, how depressing is that? But there's good news. Because a man who let everything slip through his fingers, a man who started off so well but ended so poorly, here's the good news. Yes, there were consequences for some of the lifestyle choices, but I love this, God was not finished with Samson. The Bible says that his hair began to grow again. I love that statement. When I read that, his hair began to grow again after it had been shaved. What is his hair? What is his hair? His hair was the sign that he was separated unto God. That was part of the Nazarite vow, and that was an outward sign that I'm separated unto God. And it says that his hair began to grow. How good is God that his hair began to grow? That, my friend, is the grace of God. That, my friend, shows the love of God. What an incredible picture of God's grace to all of us. Why we were yet sinners. Remember that verse? Why we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. Why we were at our worst, God gave us his best. That's the grace of God. Quick review. Now, if you have your Bibles or some kind of electronic device, I encourage you to open up to Judges chapter 16. We're going to look at the tail end of Samson's life as we wrap up this series this morning. We're going to pick up the story actually in verse 20. Judges chapter 16 and verses 20. You can follow along as I read, or you can just listen as I read. It says in verse 20, "Then she called Samson," this is Delilah, picking up the back part of the story last week. "Then she said," she called Samson, "the Philistines are upon you." He awoke from his sleep and thought, "I'll go out as before and shake myself free." But he did not know that the Lord had left him. Then the Philistines seized him, gouged out his eyes, took him down to Gaza, binding him with bronze shackles. They set him to grinding grain in the prison. But the hair on his head began to grow again after he had been shaved. Now the rulers of the Philistines assembled to offer a great sacrifice to Dagon their god and to celebrate, saying, "Our God has delivered Samson, our enemy, into our hands." When the people saw him, they praised their god, saying, "Our God has delivered our enemy into our hands, the one who laid waste our land and multiplied our slain." In other words, they're saying, "Our God is bigger than your God. Our God is stronger than your God." That's what they're doing. And while they were in high spirits, that really means there's probably was a lot of Jack Daniels. While they were in high spirits, they shouted, "Bring out Samson to entertain us." So they called Samson out of the prison, and he performed for them. When they stood him among the pillars, Samson said to the servant who held his hand, "Put me where I can feel the pillars that support the temple, so that I may lean against them." Now the temple was crowded with men and women. All the rulers of the Philistines were there. Remember, the Philistines are the enemies of the Israelites. It says, all the rulers of the Philistines were there, and on the roof were about 3,000 men and women watching Samson perform. Then Samson prayed to the Lord, "Sovereign Lord, remember me. Please, God, strengthen me just one more, and let me, with one blow, revenge on the Philistines for my two eyes." Then Samson reached toward the two central pillars on which the temple stood, bracing himself against them, his right hand on one and his left hand on the other. Samson said, "Let me die with the Philistines." Then he pushed with all of his might, and down came the temple on the rulers and all the people in it. Thus he killed many more when he died than while he was alive. Then his brothers and his fathers, his whole family went down to get him. They brought him back and buried him between Zorah and Eshtaol in the tomb of Manoah, his father. He had led Israel 20 years. May God help us to see and understand and savor this amazing grace, this outrageous mercy that is demonstrated in this story. As I've been reading through the story, you know, a number of times throughout this last 5 weeks, I've been reading through it over and over and over again. I've asked myself, why is this story even in the Bible? Seriously. In fact, I ask that every time I read one of the Old Testament stories. Why is this story in the Bible? And as I was thinking about that, I was reminded of a story in Luke chapter 24. You may remember this. The men who are walking on the road to Emmaus. Jesus has just been crucified. He's been buried. And these two men are walking along on the road to Emmaus. They're downtrodden. They're discouraged because the one they had put all their hope in was now dead. That's all they knew. They saw him on the cross. They saw him die. They saw him being buried. And they're on their way home. And all their hopes had been in this one man named Jesus. All their dreams seemed to be vanished when he was put into the tomb. And so the scripture says in Luke chapter 24, these two are walking along, and a stranger appears. And they begin to interact. Basically, the stranger is saying, "So why are you so discouraged? Why so gloom? What's happened?" And they're kind of like astonished. "What do you mean you don't know what happened? They've just crucified a couple days ago Jesus of Nazareth. We thought he would deliver us from Rome. We thought he was the guy." And he wasn't. And so this conversation goes on. And then it says, we discover, by the way, the stranger is Jesus, the resurrected Jesus. And I love this part in Luke chapter 24, when Jesus is talking to them, it says he opened up the scriptures. Let me just find that for you so I say that right. Luke chapter 24, should have had this marked. Okay, Luke chapter 24, it says, and beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he explained to them what was said in all the scriptures concerning himself. In other words, Jesus opens up the Old Testament and shows people that every story, every event pointed to him. Every story that we read points to Jesus Christ. I love, there's a storybook written by Sally Lloyd-Jones. And it's all these Bible stories. And in this children's Bible story, every story, she shows where Jesus is in the picture. I love what she says. She says, every story in the Old Testament whispers the name of Jesus. Every story in the Old Testament. And so as Samson's story is unfolded to us here in Judges chapter 13, 14, 15, and 16, we think Samson's the main character. He's center stage. That's where all the attention needs to be. But as we begin to read the story and get a little closer look, we realize that Jesus is actually on center stage and that he's actually always the hero of every story that we read in the Bible. So when you read the Bible, I would encourage you, look for Jesus. Like, where is Jesus in this story? Because God speaks to us through his word. He speaks to us through his son. So back in Judges chapter 13, the Bible tells us that Samson was to begin the deliverance. Judges were always raised up for Israel to deliver them from their enemies. But Samson is the only judge that wasn't told to deliver that he would deliver the people of Israel. He was just told he would begin the deliverance. And so after 20 years of leading the people of Israel, quite honestly, hasn't done much as to what he has been called to do. The Philistines are not defeated until, this is really amazing, until Samson is at his weakest. His hair is shaved, his eyes are gouged out, he's chained like an animal in a circus. And he finally realizes that he is weak and God alone is strong. And so he prays. He prays and asks God for a generous portion of strength. And God answers his prayer. And Samson brings down this stadium on himself and all the lords of the Philistine. It is when Samson is actually at his weakest that he is the most powerfully used. The hope of the Christian faith, by the way, is not dependent on our strength. It's dependent on God's strength. I think God is often in the business of destroying our idols of self-sufficiency. So we know that really our sufficiency is in God and God alone. See, God's storeroom of grace is actually when we're at the end of the rope. When we're just hanging on, that's where his storeroom of grace is. And the thing we like to admit the least is the one thing that really sets us free, and that is we're weak. We need someone to deliver us. The message of the gospel will only make sense to those who literally are at their wit's end. Those who have run and there's just nowhere else to run to. Counterintuitive, isn't it? That our weakness is our greatest strength. So the Christian life is a progression, but it's not a progression upward. See, I think sometimes that's what we get that confused. We think it's from, you know, that we go from weakness to strength, but it's actually the opposite. You know, there's this phrase I've heard, and I don't really care for it. It's this one right here. Live strong Christianity. You know, I think, was it Armstrong, right? The Lance Armstrong. You know, live strong. He had those bracelets that's, you know, going through cancer. But somehow that has been translated into Christianity. And I want to tell you, this live strong Christianity is exhausting, and it's enslaving. When we have to be the one who's always strong. The strength of God alone is what liberates us from this burden of needing to be strong. The sufficiency of God alone can relieve the weight that we carry, thinking that we have to be the ones to be sufficient. Christian growth is not, by the way, Christian growth is not, I'm getting stronger, and I'm getting stronger, and I'm getting more competent, and I'm getting more competent. That's not the Christian life where you grow in your faith. Christian growth is where we become more aware of just how weak we are and how incompetent we can be and how competent and strong Jesus is. You know, remember that story? Some of you may remember it, the story of Gideon. You know, again, another judge. God has, you know, called Gideon to lead the people of Israel, to lead them out from underneath the Mennonites, who are the enemies. And so they're going to go to war. Gideon has 32,000 men to go to battle. And at that point, he still has less men than the enemy. And God says to Gideon, actually, it's too many men. At that point, you go, oh, no, Lord, have you, recount. I only have 32,000 men. They have so many, it's like grasshoppers in the field. You can't even count them all. And God says, no, actually, Gideon, you have too many men. He says, tell the people, if anybody here is scared to go to battle, if anyone's nervous about, you know, that their family's going to be left behind, they're going to lose their business, whatever. If you're scared, if you're nervous, just go back home. You don't need to go to fight. And it says that 22,000 left. 22,000 people left, leaving Gideon with 10,000 men. At that is like, this is crazy stuff, God. What are you doing? Only 10,000. There's so many over there. They're equipped. They're ready to go to battle. God says, actually, Gideon, it's funny that you bring that up because you have too many men. And so he says, take all the soldiers down to the riverbank and see how they drink water. Those who maybe just kind of kneel on their knee and have their sword and bend over and drink out of their hand like they're a soldier looking around, send those home. Those who literally get down on their knees and drink the water like a dog out of the river, keep those guys. So 9,700 go home. The ones who, you know, you think, no, those are sharp. They're ready for battle. They're prepared. They're looking. No, no. I'll take the 300. Then God says, hey, you know what? We're gonna swap out some of your armor, some of your weapons. Let's get rid of all those knives, swords, and shields, and spears, and let's give everyone a trumpet. That should do it. Play enough music bad enough, people will run. And so they're given a lantern and a trumpet. You know why I think God did all this? Because God wanted to make it obvious that their promised victory had nothing to do with their own strength. This was going to be a God thing. That was going to be accomplished, not theirs. Martin Luther, one of the great reformers of the church who lived in the 1400s, said, there's a lot of bad stuff in the Bible. And we'd all agree with that. There's a lot of bad stuff in the Old Testament. And such a story like Samson. So let's be honest, the Old Testament is not PG. It isn't. As much as we would like it to be, it has more of an R rating. It really is. I mean, there's murder, there's adultery, there's rape, there's incest, there's sexual immorality, pride and selfishness and deception. I mean, the Old Testament is more like R rated. It makes R rated movies look like vanilla ice cream. That's how, when you start reading it, that's the truth. And Martin Luther said, the bad stuff that we read in the Old Testament is intended to point out our sin. So when we read all that bad stuff, he says, it's to point out our sin. We've messed up. And there's a lot of bad stuff in the Old Testament and in the New Testament too. But it's supposed to show us our sin. And all the good stuff, he said, is not to shine the light on the one doing the good, but the point is that there's only one who can do good, namely Jesus. And I think that helps us have a better understanding when we're reading some of these Old Testament stories. That when we look at some of the bad, it's just to remind us of who we are. And then we see that God, you know, uses a deliverer, a temporary deliverer, and we know that ultimately we were in need of a deliverer who would set us free from our sins. There's good stuff and there's bad stuff that we read about Samson. And there's some really bad stuff actually about Samson. It's kind of a mixed bag, which is really like a lot of our lives. And so Samson's greatest victory was when he was at his weakest. His prayer was, one last time, will you just give me strength in my weakness? Sounds a lot like what the Apostle Paul said when he said, when I'm weak, then am I strong. Doesn't even seem to make sense. But he says, when I'm weak, I am strong. When I realize at a heart level, Paul says, that this whole thing, my life, this world, meaning, security, purpose, value, worth, when I realize that these things are not riding on my shoulders, it sets me free to live the way God's called me to live. Life takes on a brand new meaning. See, I used to work to validate, Paul says, to validate my existence. Now I can work for great joy. He says, I used to work to justify my worth, trying to secure my value, but now I can work with the pressure off of me. Before, I needed to be perfect, he says, but now I don't. Before, I needed to be special, but now I don't, he says. I've been set free. And so when the pressure is off from perfection, we become much more productive. Much more productive. When you are weak, then are you strong. I don't know, have you ever had someone come up to you and said, wow, faith is so strong. Maybe you've even said it to somebody. Your faith is so strong. I've had people say that to me. Oh, Donald, your faith is so strong. And I'm like, if you really knew The truth is, sometimes I feel like I'm just hanging on the edge of the rope. There's times I just want to quit, throw in the towel. I'm just barely hanging on. But people say, oh, your faith, it's inspiring. And yet you feel like you're at your weakest. And when you are weak, then he becomes strong. Because he shows up. And my friend, this is good news. That's good news. That is the good news of the gospel. God gave us his best while we were at our worst. As I said, the Christian faith, it is a progression, but it isn't a progression from weakness to strength. It's from strength to weakness. The Apostle Paul thought he was strong. If you read through his resume, he bragged at the beginning. He bragged about himself. He said he felt justified by his resume. He said, well, I was circumcised on the eighth day. I'm a Pharisee of the Pharisees. I'm a Hebrew of the Hebrews. I have had flawless in my attendance and adherence to the law of God. I'm at the top of my game. That's what the Apostle Paul said. Before he became Apostle Paul, when he was Saul. I'm at the top of my game. There's nobody like me. I am good. I'm getting better and better as the days go by. And no one will argue the Apostle Paul is probably one of the greatest Christians who ever lived. But when you follow his life, you discover that God systematically breaks him down. God takes Paul off his high horse. In fact, do you know what Paul says at the end of his life? He says, I'm the worst guy I know, actually. He started off with saying, I'm the best guy I know. There's no one in town like me. And at the end, he comes to the conclusion when he sees his own heart and he just says, I'm actually one of the worst guys I know. Paul's life bears witness to this truth, and so does Samson's life. The one thing that can actually set us free is admitting we're weak. It is the strength of God that can release us from the burden of being strong. And it is a burden, by the way, to feel like you have to do it all. A burden. The sufficiency of God relieves us from the pressure of being sufficient ourselves. The strength and sufficiency crescendos years later after this event when Jesus arrived on the scene. Because God sent another deliverer who wouldn't just begin the deliverance, but would actually deliver them. There are some things that Samson, actually, and Jesus have in common. Both of them had their births announced by an angel. Both of them had their mothers spoken to by an angel about these boys. Samson's mother was barren. Jesus' mother was a virgin. Both Samson and Jesus were tapped as rescuers right from the beginning. But Samson was only a precursor, because in chapter 13 it says he would only begin the deliverance. Jesus brought God's deliverance of completion. When he shed it on the cross, it is finished. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Samson to bring death. In chapter 4 of Luke, it says the Spirit of the Lord came upon Jesus to bring life. Completely different. And Jesus says, I've come to set the captive free. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me, Jesus says, and I've come to make the blind see again. Interesting. Samson ends his life as a blind man. Jesus, I have come to set or to liberate the oppressed. I have come to deliver good news to the broken, the depressed, the messed up, the weary, the worn out. And both Samson and Jesus saved their people through their death. Samson's death destroyed God's enemies. Jesus' death delivered God's enemies. And my friend, that is good news. That is good news. And that's why we call the gospel good news, that Jesus is strong and I'm free to be weak. In other words, because Jesus is strong, I am free to admit that I'm weak and I cannot do this on my own. And that's why Jesus said it is finished. It's his work, not yours. It's his strength, not yours. And may God show us the magnificent story of the gospel through this story of Samson. Help us to be able to savor this life-saving grace. so that we could leave here a little lighter this morning than what we came in. Because it's not about us and our performance and our perfection. It's about what Jesus did that can set us free. Let's pray. Father, this morning, thank you. Thank you for the story of Samson that we've invested the last 5 weeks in. So much for us to learn. And we look at Samson's life and we see ourselves. The truth is we've made poor decisions in our life. We've messed up. We're flawed. We get all that. No one has to convince us of that. And so, Lord, this morning, I just want to say thank you that you made a way through your son Jesus. Lord, that it wasn't left for us to find a way or the way, but you made it for us. And so, Lord, this morning, for those who may be here, whose hearts have been heavy, maybe they're on that treadmill of performance, 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 trying to meet your expectations, God, I pray that they would be set free today, recognizing it's you that's accomplished it all. You said it's finished. No longer do we have to perform. And so, Lord, we just thank you for the grace of God that extends to us day after day after day. It never grows old. And is always offered to those of us who least deserve it. That's the grace of God. We celebrate that this morning, and we thank you for it. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand as we close with some music?
Every heartbreak, through every circumstance, I believe that you are my fortress, you are my portion, you are my hiding place. I believe you are the way, the truth, protector, you are the one I love. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, set on you, and you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay long when I am here with you. It's a new horizon, and I'm set on you. And you meet me here today with mercies that are new. All my fears and doubts, they can all come too, because they can't stay alone when I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. the truth, the life. I believe you are the way, the truth, the life. I believe you